He graduated from the University of Medicine and Dentistry, New Jersey Dental School. He's been practicing for over 34 years. Prior to entering dental school, he earned a master's degree in human anatomy at Fairleigh Dickinson University School of Dentistry. After graduating from dental school, he entered a one-year residency program in oral facial pain. And he received a doctorate in integrative medicine and naturopathic medicine from Capital University in 1999. He is a professor emeritus in integrative medicine from Capital University of Integrative Medicine. He's currently professor of integrative biologic dental medicine at the American College of Integrative Medicine and Dentistry, which is in New Jersey. He has been attending at Hackensack University Medical Center for over 25 years, and he's the section chief of oral facial pain and a senior lecturer. He heads an international team of dental researchers studying the effects of oxygen ozone therapy in dentistry. He is chairman of the Institutional Review Board for Human Studies at the American College of Integrative Medicine and Dentistry, and he has pioneered and developed the many applications of oxygen ozone in dentistry. That's true. He's an author, national and international speaker on subjects such as ozone, biologic dentistry, and naturopathic medicine. Without further ado, Dr. Phil Mollica.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for coming, and good night, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, after that interview. All right, so is everyone still awake out there? I can barely see you with the sun shining on me over here. I want to thank the warm-up act so far this morning. Bringing me to where we're going to talk about periodontal disease and biologic concepts. So, I'm a chairman of the periodontal, and we call it the Associated Soft Tissue Committee. And our mission really here as a committee within the IAOMT is really to look at current research, biologic trends, and also to help educate you guys about biology in reference to periodontal disease and the progression and different concepts and thinking a little bit differently about how to approach periodontal disease, if we really even want to call it that. So our goals today is to present the official position of the International Academy of Oral Medicine and Toxicology in relationship to diagnosis and treatment of periodontal disease. But in addition, we want to talk a little bit about the concept of integrative biology and integrated biologic dental medicine and its relationship and support of the treatment of periodontal therapy. So let's hop right out of the box, because if you're here, you're already thinking out of the box of traditional dentistry. That is certainly for sure. So let's think in an integrated biologic manner and tell our story today. Now, I'm going to keep on going. I got a whole bunch of slides. I got a whole bunch of stuff that I've added on. So if we run out of time, they'll have to give me the hook and yank me off today. So hang on as we roll through this. So, you know, we always love to see the forest from the trees, which is kind of opposite thinking, or the trees from the forest, but we certainly do love our trees. We love those beautiful trees within that. But we can take those kind of biologic concepts and really apply those thoughts, you know, keep in mind our dear friend, the epithelial cell. You say, well, geez, I haven't heard about the epithelial cell since maybe dental school, hygiene school. You know, these cells really make up our tree. So, you know, why should we concern ourselves so much about nurturing and taking care of and supporting the epithelial cell? Well, when you think about that in dentistry, we are nurturing, supporting epithelial cells as multiple various ways within the oral cavity itself. So keep that thought in mind about the epithelial cell. And we're going to think a little bit differently. You know, traditional, you know, we've always thought in medicine and dentistry, if you're on the dental school or hygiene school, is very linear thinking. Everything's black and white. You know, you go to dental school, kids come through our practice, they spend some time with us, they say, look, all the cool things you see here we're doing with homeopathy, detoxification, mercury, all this kind of stuff, forget it. You go to dental school, hygiene school, do exactly what they say, do it, get out, and get your license to kill like the rest of us. So we want to think in a linear fashion that was going in the past, you know, the cause and effect thinking. You know, organisms were nothing but a machine. This goes back to the early concepts of medicine and dentistry. You know, the old drug to sell, the key and lock key, you get a response. And with linear thinking in medicine and dentistry, once again, it goes back to that cause and effect. You know, the drug kills the bug, okay, that immediate effect that we see, okay, we can easily objectify that. But that's great for an acute situation. The world we live in today is really different. We're seeing as our aging population comes along, environmental things are coming in, affecting our bodies. What we're really seeing is chronicity today. We're seeing patients all the time. I mean, you must all see the same thing. Patients coming in with chronic diseases, degenerative diseases, what they call non-communicable diseases. Non-communicable diseases that are unique to the individual itself. And these are slow degenerative diseases that we're seeing today. And we're seeing that reflected in the oral cavity. So how do we deal with that differently than we've done with that in the past? And of course, dealing with the concept of tumors. Where are these tumors coming from? When you start thinking biologically, you have to start really get back to the concept of the human body as a whole. And it is the ultimate web of webs, an enormous web. It's vast, it's intricate, it's completely connected. And everything you do, every subtle thing you do, from fillings, restorations, periodontal treatment, affects the entire biologic system. And we are the kaleidoscope. We really are. Because every single thing that we do affects everything in one way or the other. We get in there, do our hygiene work, our restoration work. Those things are changing the ecosystem and possibly orthopedics of the entire body. Believe me, when you deliver anesthesia, let's do an inferior alveolar block, our favorite, right? Stick that needle in. Believe me, your little toe recognizes you just got stuck in the face with a needle. We are that connected. We are but one thing. Since we are a biologic system, we are not linear in no matter shape or form. We're highly interconnected, interlinked. It's really a biologic but an energetic system. Energy flows throughout the body where it's really needed. There's a connectivity to the body itself. So it's important that the body has the capability to exchange information. Information is going on clearly throughout your body continuously. When information starts to become skewed, that's when we go down into the rabbit hole itself. So the most important thing in any biologic system is information and the processing of information. You know, our little epithelial cells, they're wonderful. They, you know, they love to cuddle. You know, they cuddle together. They're, if one of them's not feeling well, they'll share a little food with them and a little energy, et cetera. But the reality is that they have to be told what to do. They're dumb little guys. But there has to be information coming that's clearly interpreted so they do what they're supposed to do. It's when that information is not getting to them or skewed information is getting to those cells itself. That's when we start to see that drifting away and that a pathologic world itself. So information is the most subtle energy there is carrier within the human body. And this is where the concepts of homeopathy come in, where homeopathy is what? Information. You're helping the body do what it should do naturally itself. So when you think about it, we're starting to think into a different world of biology today. We're starting to think about things that's called quantum biology, quantum physics applied to biology. And that's really a different important concept where our information can travel through the body. Because when you think about it, you have three-dimensional molecules themselves transferred in a hot, wet medium, traveling at light speed. How the hell does that go on? How does this amazing body itself continuously balance itself and share information at light speed? We're talking at things where, you know, with the new biology going on, the concept of quantum physics has to apply to those deeper inner information that travels through the body itself. So it's important that our body's functioning at the best level it possibly can in this nice little wet medium so this information can be shared properly and the body functions correctly. So in the biologic world, when we talk about information coming in, you know, in this example here, I have a healthy liver. Information is coming in. The cells are appropriately reacting. They're functioning correctly. They're getting right proper information. Their genes are turning on and off. Proteins are being made. They're doing their job. But when we start to get noise, things become toxic. We're seeing the world of toxicity. Our biggest issues today are what? Ecological issues, environmental issues. Once those things start to accumulate, the information becomes skewed and can't be transferred into the cells, and we see a lot of noise coming in the cells. All they're going to do is respond to the information that they have. Well, how's that happening? So you're going to get noise, and then eventually you have an unhealthy liver, for example, And ultimately, we see these chronic diseases and cancer itself. So when you consider the integrity of cells and tissue, it's all about ecology, the ecological relationship of the cells, which make up the tissue, but it's the biology underneath it, okay? You talk about body ecology, you're talking about the human microbiome, which we're hearing more and more about. The interesting thing is that what's coming out, we're really what's called a superorganism. A superorganism. In reality, we are really only 10% mammalian cells. 10% mammal cells, the things, oh. And our focus has always been on, let's take care of the cells itself, focus on that, develop drugs around that. But 90% of us is microbes. 90% of us are microbes. We are the ultimate petri dish. Now, whether that petri dish is healthy or not, that's a separate issue itself. So when we can start considering now things, we're looking differently biologically. As we nurture and try to take care of our dear epithelial cells, we also should think about nurturing, caring for those 90% of the rest of us, the microbes, because there's an intimate relationship between those microbes and what they are and who they are and how our mammalian cells function. It's symbiotic. As we go about banging down, killing the bugs all over us, we're really disrupting how we function at a normal physiological biochemical level, because those bugs contribute a tremendous amount of information to how we function. And we see that just recently, where I think it was the FDA came out about all those sanitizers, hand sanitizers. Oh, they're great, they're great. They're creating more problems than they're worth. Soap and water, very simple, versus sanitizing. Sanitize, you got to get a little dirty once in a while. It's fun, believe me. So when you talk about biologic ecosystems, a relationship, let's say, to the human body, at the base of it, at the very base, building up through the entire ecosystem in our body, we start at the oral cavity in the bowel. Because, you know, the old saying, death starts in the bowel. Death starts in the bowel. Well, why are we concerned about the bowel? Well, the bowel, really, the gut, where does it start? Right here, at the oral cavity, and we certainly know where it ends, that's for sure. But the basis for that is so important. As we're nurturing the oral cavity, we also have to nurture the GI tract. Because where does our immune system live? In the gut. 70 to 80% of how we perceive the world, our immune system, is in the gut. That's the true perception of the world. You know, we think our perception of the world, I can see, I can hear, I can taste, all the kind of touch, everything else. But underneath that, you know, our energetic challenge, our environment is being constantly monitored by every time you swallow, you're swallowing the environment. And your body has to sort it out. Is it an attack? Is it an antigenic response? How do we perceive the world? And this goes on through your GI tract. But it starts in the oral cavity. In the oral cavity. So that starts in the bowel, and it reflects of your healthy bowel, healthy oral cavity. That reflects on how clean our blood is, liver function, all the way through up to the higher centers. So we have a great responsibility, more than we ever thought about, as we think about us being as biologically based. So I know last night, Bill Virtue, you know, he was lecturing this morning. I see Bill back there. He was saying, Phil, how does this information get to a cell? You know, nutrients get to a cell, oxygen, you know. How does, you know, Griff came up here and says, Phil, how does metabolic waste remove from the cell? How does all this happen? These are really deep thinkers, you know. We thought about that. Well, these are critical questions. How does that happen? Well, that happens through what's called the extracellular matrix or the biologic terrain. Biologic terrain. It's one of the first things we teach in our biologic school. Every function, every process in the human body involves the matrix in one way or the other. This extracellular matrix is really the unifying the theory of the physical mammalian body. If you took away everything else except the extracellular matrix, you'd have a perfect outline of the human body. This is what connects us. This is the interface between the vascular system, the lymphatic system, the nervous system, and the cells themselves. Every nutrient, every metabolic byproduct, water sieves, everything has to do to get to a cell in an intelligent way has to go through this matrix, then go to the cells, be processed properly, and then think about it, the cells with their byproducts, whether it's proteins, hormones, whatever their job is, metabolic byproducts, have to carefully be put back through the matrix and intelligently move through the matrix itself back into the vascular lymphatic system itself, and to keep things balanced well, goes move along. So all immune responses, tissue repair grows through the matrix cell. And this is when, you know, today we like to talk about, you know, I want to detoxify my body, I want to alkalinize my body. This is what you're detoxifying first. You're cleaning out the matrix itself. You're alkalinizing the matrix itself. When you start getting more, I'm more acidic, I'm more this, like that's these acids are building up in the matrix area. So as you're slowly alkalinizing yourself to a better state of health, what you're doing is alkalinizing the matrix because it functions at a higher level, at a more alkaline state. So you can see here, there's a very simple diagram here of a vascular system here, capillary bed. But all these proteins, sugar proteins, matrix here, allowing in an intelligent way, it's highly regulated by the autonomic nervous system. It's a highly regulated, intelligent area that allows the flow of all these nutrients, water, information to flow into the cell to cell. So when this matrix becomes toxic or acidic or heavy metals like mercury, et cetera, becomes toxic, bad information goes through or no information at all. And this is when we see the degeneration of our favorite little friend, the epithelial cell. Now, when you think about the epithelial cell, and you look at cells themselves, you know, you always think, well, where's the intelligence of the cell? Excuse me. Where's the brain of the cell? You know, growing up, everybody thought, well, it's got to be the nucleus. It looks like a brain. That's for sure. Well, the reality is the intelligence of a cell is at the cell membrane itself. That's where the thinking goes on. Because this is actually, I love this diagram itself. I'm trying to remember where I even got it. Where we thought about membranes, they're just kind of like cellophane wrapped around a sack of all kinds of cool things inside. But the reality, it's extremely dynamic. It's intimately linked into this matrix. This is where everything is one. There are no separations in the human body. That's why all the type of things, these infections, all the different heavy metals, et cetera, that we're dealing with the oral cavity, there are no barriers. I mean, dental school, I don't think there's anything attached below the jaw. Okay? There was nothing about it. It just happened to be a body carrying a head in, but nothing existed below there. Nonsense. Nonsense. Deeper infections, all these chronicity problems associated with the face and the oral cavity, drain all the way. Gravity sucks and just drains everything down. But if you look at the cellular level, once again, you can see the intimate relationship between the cell membrane, which is phospholipids, okay, proteins in the center, but you have these sieves, these pathways that allow information to travel into the cell, travels through these lattice system cells. Cells have skeletal systems, there's intelligence in there, and the nucleus itself is really what, where DNA lies, RNA. Those are protein factories. Raw proteins come out of there as a response as the information comes to the cell and is modified as it goes through the rest of the part of the cell and eventually released into the biologic system itself. So it's an amazing, amazing system that we support and nurture itself. So when you think about cells itself, I have all different kind of factors coming in through the matrix itself. You have differentiation, all these different cell shapes, all these things contribute to the functionality and health and wellness of the cell itself. So we're building our story really from the cellular level up, and then we'll get into the clinical aspect. And remember, we are an open energetic system. Infections, problems, etc., in the oral cavity drift everywhere in the human body. And it's how the body responds to these pathogens is really where the issue lies. So in functional life, we really think about the capillary, the cell itself, the extracellular matrix, but also start thinking differently about this concept. We hear more and more of the microbiome, and we can start nurturing that concept also. So if you think about a cell, you know, it's really, we always think about the cell as morphologically, it's a nice little cube, it's a beautiful thing, but the cells themselves and how they function and how they look, et cetera, are really a reflection of the environment they live in. We are an ecosystem. We are an ecosystem, and your environment really dictates how the cells function and how you function, your ultimate outcomes and longevity in life. And so factors, then we talk about cell biology, we talk about the matrix itself, growth factors, cytokines, information coming, all the things we touched on. And it's even beyond genetic programming, you know, genes turning on and off, and those are a reflection of the environment also. And of course, growth, shape, differentiation, developmental responses in cell. But the amazing thing about the human body, when I was in anatomy school, it always amazed me. I was trained as a classical anatomist before I went into any kind of clinical setting. So, you know, in anatomy school, you know, you're part of the old gravedigger club, you know, you have old bodies hanging around, you live with the dead for a couple of years, and, you know, we can name all kinds of structures. And, you know, we dissect the bodies, God knows how many bodies we did, it was in a dental school, we used to teach the dental students anatomy, and you see all these kind of amazing things, these huge calcium plaques, lines of, you know, plaque lining the abdominal aortas, all these different tumors in these people. And, you know, as a, you know, just an anatomist, well, that's kind of cool. I don't know what the hell it is. But it's amazing how much the human body can handle and take before it gives up the ghost. It's amazing what we can do to ourselves before we've just had enough. But because we have that, what's called homeostasis, and really it's biologic elasticity. We have the capability of rebounding and compensating into our body for insults coming from different ways. Thunderstorms, droughts, everything else known to man, beatings of our body, starvation, whatever the case may be. Given the right things again, we can heal ourselves. We can go back. Well, body loves to be balanced. I don't like to be balanced, man. Well, it goes beyond the spiritual concept. Physiologically, biochemically, we're balanced. But it's about ecology. Keep driving that point. Because the microbes make us. And we tell it, develop our story today. You'll see where the role of microbes are more important than you can ever, ever imagine. And we're coming to understand that more and more. So in our wonderful world of dentistry, it's amazing we actually get out alive. I always cheer dentists who finally get out alive, okay? Because we're dealing with chemicals, solvents, infections, heavy metals, environmentals. I mean, the things you learn at this academy to protect yourself from the things that we do are critical. I'm sure this morning you went over procedures to protect yourself from mercury. Mercury is what's the second most toxic substance in humanity? And we're woohoo, we're just drilling away. When I first started practicing dentistry, you know, I walked into a clinic one day. I got a great job. You know, I'm used to treating, what, 2 patients a day? Wow, that's a big deal. I go in, there's 18 people waiting for me. I almost had a heart attack. And you know what? I was doing mercury-based fillings. I don't know what the hell I was doing. And it was like jars of mercury at pellets. And it was great. Add a little extra mercury. Make it creamy so I can smear it in, you know, beat up that mercury. And I'm like, oh, man, that office must be condemned by now, I tell you. So all these different factors as we go through, try to protect ourselves and the patient himself, really contribute to bad information in the body, which ultimately we call with dysregulations or anaerobiosis. This is how we metabolically manage oxygen within our system itself. And, you know, listen, you know, we try to do all the things, eat healthy food, organic food, whatever that might mean these days. But things sometimes accumulate. You know, there's a misstep here, and we start to go into that free fall. And we've all seen this with our patients. You know, you ever see the patients that are dying for 30 years? I don't know if you've been around that long, but eventually, if you're around dentistry long, you see things that you built years ago start to fail. And also, the patients that have to be attached to fail also. Okay, so things build up in your ecosystem. You know, you start getting those abnormalities, those heavy metals. You're becoming more acidic. You're not hydrating well. You're taking all kinds of weird pharmaceuticals. Does everybody enjoy watching the pharmaceutical commercials on TV? Isn't that great? If your rectum falls out, call us. And then lawyer commercial comes right after that. If your rectum falls out, even if you're dead, please call us. Okay, I'll call from the grave. Thank you. Anyhow, where were we? Oh, yes. So anyhow, you get these abnormalities in the extracellular matrix. And it's going to affect how the cell biology is working. Then eventually, you know, when that starts to build up, the cells start to change. You're going to start to see this pathologic drifting of the cells themselves. And then eventually we see that as disease. Remember, when we see diseases in our body, cancers, whatever the case, this is not like it happened yesterday. These things slowly evolve over time. Even periodontal disease, if we want to call it that, evolve over time. It's not like, oh, I was perio-free yesterday, now I got periodontal disease. No, it's a progression. And things start at a deeper, deeper level until we eventually see the manifestation at the clinical level. It's moved quite a ways along itself. So we have this ecologic environment, you know, an anaerobiotic, acidic environment, dysregulated, bad information is going into the system itself, and we want to ecologically shift things to a more balanced, harmonic environment that's conducive to health and wellness, good oxygenation, and balanced environment to allow our body to go back into homeostasis. So thinking biologically now, we're thinking ecologically also. How can we support the patient's own inherent healing systems themselves? So we want to go from a dysregulated environment, bad information environment, and use our biologic concept, our biologic therapies, to shift it to a more regulated environment that the body's talking to itself again, getting the information in, getting the nutrients in, the hydration in, all the information that's appropriate to allow the healing process to go along. One of the things we try to do with our docs that we train, we talk about becoming dental healers, not dental mechanics, which you pop out of dental school. We want to become healers, support the patient's innate healing processes in the cell. So you have an anaerobiotic, a bad metabolic issue with oxygen and how it's utilized, dysregulated environment, and we see this clinically in perio where we see this oxidation going on. We have a chronic oxidative state where we're seeing lymphatic and vascular congestion, that swelling of the tissue itself, that changing of the color itself, the breaking down of the endothelium, etc. And we wind up with these ischemic diseases we see in jaws and even around the soft tissue itself. And this is a case where you have, and I'll show you, an osteonecrosis of the jaw. This is bisphosphonate-induced osteonecrosis of the jaw. This is classic representation of a system that's been poisoned, and it's dysregulated. The osteoclasts have been poisoned. The tissue breaks down, the periosteum. And then what happens? Opportunistic pathogens move in. The ecology has changed. And remember, the environment reflects what the microbiomes do. All those microbes are a reflection of that specific environment, okay? So we see we have osteonecrosis of the jaw. We're looking here in particular. We're actually looking at the roof of someone's mouth here, of the sinus itself. Here's a piece of maxilla that's been poisoned. You can see the tissue is dysregulated here. This tissue, the vascular beds are breaking down. It doesn't, you know, it's losing the capability of healing. And we can see hunks of bone coming out of the patient's head. I always show this piece here. This is the floor of the maxillary sinus of this patient, and this is the alveolus itself, okay? This is a result of the vascular beds collapsing down. We're seeing the matrix collapsing down. This is a dysregulated environment that's ultimately reduced down to necrosis of the tissues and cells itself. But here, if we support the patient properly, we start to get the tissue start to re-regulate itself for detoxification, getting oxygen flowing in, reestablishing blood supply. You know, it's all osteopathy, good blood flow in, good blood flow out. Things start to heal itself. So then you look at the patient's innate healing processes, support that, and we can get this because we're looking here, once again, at that roof of that mouth, but we're able to get re-epithelialization and good information, allow that healing process to go in. So when you talk about dysregulated tissue we see here, through our biologic efforts, we can eventually help this patient through a number of different type of therapies to allow that healing process to go back in here. Okay? So when we think about periodontal disease or even osteonecrosis of the jaw, we're thinking, you know, integratively, our biologic medicine, we want hydration, nutrition, all different elements to come together. Usually it's a summation of things. That's why we love the integrative model, because there's all different pieces of the puzzle come together, support that healing process, but also keeping in mind that matrix, that underpinning matrix, to reestablish that. Because if we don't reestablish that matrix, it allows this wonderful stuff to get back into the system, it just won't get the healing process to go. Just a little bit thinking. And of course, we have different kinds of patients in New Jersey. This is my son, Tankenstein. Looks like his dad, don't he? This is on Monday morning. He just doesn't want to get out of bed. So once again, we're thinking about different, you know, that's why I love the integrative model, because all medicine and dentistry is on one level playing field, and we pick what's really appropriate for the patient. Everyone is really unique. Everyone's truly unique itself. So when you think about wellness and health, we really want to repair and restore and renew the patient's healing processes, and really putting those pieces together, the biologics, getting a diagnosis, dealing with what we consider infection or opportunistic pathogenic forms, and thinking about the microbiome, thinking differently just beyond just the mammal cells themselves, bringing that symbiotic relationship to full thing, full keel. So when you think about it, the patient really has an innate capacity to heal, given the proper support. And that's really part of the trick when you're doing integration of biologics. What elements are going to come together to support the patient's own innate healing processes? And that's one of the most key elements. So you know, dealing with oral facial pain for years, have patients come in, fix me, as an old brother. The patient has to be its own best advocate. And that's the onus you have to put on them. I said, I can help you, but you have to help yourself. And once that shift comes around with the patient, it's amazing how they can help themselves, because, you know, healing is what? Spiritual, emotional, mental, physical, okay? There's many planes of healing. And to get a good, complete healing, which is a kind of a lifetime experience, all those pieces of the elements have to really come together. But there, we're there beyond just, you know, drilling a hole in a tooth. We can be there to support and understand that's healing processes and recognize that and support that process. We can't do it for them, but we can help that. And it's amazing when you think about it biologically, that code, how does the body know how to heal itself? It's amazing that inherent code is built into the system that supports a natural healing process and that balancing of the body and healing. So our principal goals, really, you know, we want to support epithelial cells, which we're concerned about in periodontal healthcare, extracellular matrix itself, and of course, thinking about the microbiome, those 90% of us that we've neglected for so many years itself, but we're understanding more and more about it, and that really makes a healthy tissue and a healthy smile itself. So healing and supporting periodontal tissue and associated soft tissue. So we just kind of saw this model before. When we're dealing with infection, we're really dealing with mixed infection. You know, one of the most amazing things when we're working out issues of surrounding root canals and ozone therapy was when we looked deeper into the root canal issues, it was really one of the biggest issues were fungal infections. Now in dental school, I don't know, I was taught, oh, everything's bacteria, bacteria, bacteria. But you look differently now, understanding that there are mixed infections. You're not dealing with just one thing. You're dealing with thousands of things, okay? Fungus, virus, viruses inside bacteria. You know, we're dealing with a different kind of ecology, different environment. So we want to, you know, ecologically shift and regulate into a more balanced, eco-friendly microbiome and environment itself. So in our model, we don't want to think linearly, okay, in a linear fashion. You know, what's the root cause? You know, we see people do with cancers and these, what they're calling now, like I said before, these non-communicable diseases. Why the hell did that happen? Why does, quote-unquote, healthy person start to shift and things change where they kind of with the chronic disease, diabetes? I mean, you're seeing kids with diabetes today, more and more than ever. Autism, spectrum issues. What the hell's going on? Is this something new? Has it been around? We just never recognize it? What are the root causes? What's driving these things we're seeing today? What's their experience? What's the biologic underpinnings? And that's the most complicated thing, but it's a good intellectual thinking where what biologically is going on underneath? What's driving the things that we see in a clinical way? And, of course, the patient's phenomenon about being sick. It's a whole psyche associated with that. So we talk about this anaerobiosis. This was Otto Warburg's work back in the early 30s, where he got, you know, two Nobel Prizes for finding the root cause of cancer. Lack of proper oxygen metabolism. How we're utilizing oxygen in a fundamental way. Cancer cannot handle oxygen. That's why it does, you know, ozone therapies work so well with that. So when we talk about anaerobiosis, it's really an altered pathologic state of oxygen metabolism, a fermentation process, and an uncontrolled oxidative injury. And I looked at that descriptive, and I see periodontal disease being described in a biologic manner. How many patients that you've treated with perio come in for are fermenting? Okay? Are they fermenting or what? Ooh, nasty. Yeah, I figure someone would catch on to that. So this is a biologic descriptive of the periodontal disease. This is right here. This is typical New Jersey water drinking. I just want to let you know that. This is always great. I've had a number of these patients. I practice with my wife in New Jersey, and have patients come in. Oh, what's wrong with you? I have a tumor. Oh my God, where's the tumor? Right underneath my tongue. There's the tumor. Now the best is, what do? You get the Cavitron out. You blast the stuff away. Oh, it's gone. Oh, my teeth are sensitive now. Like, oh, great. There's no wind here. I can't drink cold stuff. Well, we'll ozonate it and desensitize it for you. So this is a kind of biologic descriptive of perio. So with oxygen metabolism and all the things we're dealing with today, years ago, if you look historically, let's say for homeopathy was developed around sanitation issues, okay, how your body deals with sanitation. Today, the cornerstone is environmental issues because we're dealing with, biotoxins, biocides, heavy metals, pesticides, solvents, weed killers, which are killing us, okay, making corn that's resistant to, the glycosides, right? Roundup. In dental school, we used to take shots at Roundup. I never understood that. Anyhow, and we're dealing with virus, fungus and parasites. And, of course, anaerobiosis and ecologic conditions, really not conducive to health. So when you see periodontal infection, okay, you see an uncontrolled oxidative injury there. You're seeing that congestion. The vascular system's being congested. The whole system's backing up on itself, okay? And the environment's changing. It's becoming more conducive to an unhealthy state. It's becoming more acidic, and it's environmental issues. And as the environment changes, so do the bugs that live there. And they become more pathogenic over time. So your microbiome and your oral cavity changes based on the environment that's in there. And it's dynamic. It changes rapidly based on what that ecosystem might have. So we change the environment, use our biological therapies ecologically, thinking ecologically now, into a more balanced system itself. And the big term used to be, probably still is, the oral systemic link. Remember, once again, any kind of infection, any toxins, and remember, what really gets us and wears us down is the pathogens that live in us, but it's their poop and pee that kills us, their metabolic byproducts, the exotoxins, and even when they kill each other, which they do, it's the endotoxins that are released when they die that poison the hell out of us. Poison the mammalian cells, and they start to do dopey things. The immune system goes berserk when it's poisoned by the bacteria, and we're going to get into that. So let's talk about, after that whole concept there, official recommendations of the IAOMT. Here we go. Okay. So if you look at periodontal disease, historically, it's gone through a paradigm changes. And, till today, I'm not sure we really know what it is. We have a kind of a good idea, but that could change over time also. You go back, Willoughby Miller, worked with Koch in Berlin, and they had that chemoparasitic theory of caries, and they thought the same bugs affected periodontal disease itself were caused strictly by bacteria. That's in 1890. 1920, once again, the bacterial theory was kind of abandoned. And I love the word. Nobody talks about pyorrhea. Remember that? I'm pyorrhea. You ever think that's a lost term? I think I have to start using my practice again. Ma'am, you have pyorrhea. Please save me. Anyhow, I like that. It used to be eczema and seborrhea. Remember those commercials? Now it's pyorrhea. Anyhow, so they thought, the irritation from the bugs itself. This is Dr. Merritt going back in 1920s. And it's just had the gingival thing, tartar and cavities and pyorrhea all lumped together. 1960s, they had more biologic, microbiologic testing. And it proved that plaque bacteria caused inflammation. not the tartar itself. The tartar was a byproduct of the whole situation environmentally. And they were seeing really no differences in the bacteria. So, well, it's got to be bacteria somehow, you know, living in this overgrowth of plaque, okay, this plaque thing, right? So this became the nonspecific plaque theory back in the 60s. Bill Virtue remembers that. I think he was in dental school in the 50s. Bill, were you there? 52, there you go, okay. He looks so good for his age. So back in 79, when I was about 6 years old, Loesch came up with the specific, you know, bacteria or the pathogens. He found that certain specific pathogens created toxins that produced what he called, quote-unquote, periodontal disease, meaning loss of connective tissue and bone, specific plaque theory. And this is where mechanical debridement came about. But this is where we really start with, you know, became the big widespread use of systemic antibiotics, which is really coming back to kill us today. Okay, systemic use of antibiotics for a situation that is theoretically located within the oral cavity itself. And we're seeing the results of misuse of antibiotics. And back in 86, this is when things started to shift a little bit. The first issue of the Journal of Oral Microbiology and Immunology, where it wasn't necessarily the microbes, but it was really our body's response, the immunologic aspect, the immunologic response to the specific ecology in and around the dentition itself. So, you know, there's about, you know, a thousand oral species, you know, but it's only a few pathogens. You know, there's competition going on. There's competition with these, you know, little bugs in your oral cavity. When I started dental school, I think they had them like five or six, maybe, bugs in your oral cavity. Now there's thousands, but, you know, and that's constantly changing. Your oral system, ecology shifts, so do the bugs. Okay, every bugs are different. Everyone has a unique ecosystem in their oral cavity. And those bugs, you know, listen, they like to compete. They're competitive. You know, natural selections, you know, you have what's called beneficial commensals who live with us all the time, but they're smart enough not to induce an immune attack, an immune response. They live happily symbiotically with us. They're happy. We're happy. Things are functioning really, really well. So there's not many really pathogenic species, per se, that we kind of know of, but it's really conditions that allow them to come up and start to do their nasty work that they do. So it's kind of like the historical aspect, you know, the prevalence. Well, you know, it's pretty widespread. You know, we do, you know, have parent to child. We do contaminate our kids early on. And as we well know, the microbiome is significantly different in children who have a vaginal birth versus cesarean section. I can't tell you how critically important it is to start developing that symbiotic relation, that microbiome, in children as early on in life. What they're doing now is, I mean, with children having cesarean section, they're taking swabs from the vaginal fluids and actually rubbing it in their mouth to get the proper microbiome up, because the microbiome works symbiotically with the child to develop the immune system in the proper fashion. Kids who are neglected microbiome-wise, immunologically, have a bug issue. They don't have a good microflora that works symbiotically with the immune system to produce the right immune response itself. Okay? We'll talk about BANA testing, but the BANA testing tests probably, where they're infected, and they probably a 35 to 54% chance the child is infected. So periodontal disease, if you want to call it that, is really communicable. Okay, it is a communicable disease. We like to share it. We share, okay? So the oral cavity, as the child itself, is really sterile at birth, but it's important that they really, really develop a good microflora right from the beginning, which I known years ago with my kids, to start immediately giving them probiotics, really getting that whole system up and functioning right. So once again, periodontal disease is a communicable, and it through spit, you know, saliva. We share it. We love it, okay? So, of course, you know, bacterial exchange during intimate kissing, you know, 80 million microbes are transferred during a 10-second French kiss. This is from some zombie movie a friend of mine gave me. That's it. The Walking Dead. They even suck face, you know. Anyhow, So, and some of those bacteria that we share, okay, you know, they collect and, you know, they're transient, and others, you know, take up a nice micro niche. They love, hey, this is a great place to live. I think I'll hang out for a while. So some are knocked out right away, but some tend to, you know, find a nice niche to live and have a good time in your face. So, you know, a friend of mine years ago said to me, he says, Phil, you know, periodontal disease is communicable. I said, right. He says, but you get it from wives, lovers, and dogs. I'm saying, John, what are you into with the dog scene? But, you know, this actually came from a study done in Sweden where they had a couple of kids that wound up with, they used to call like juvenile periodontitis, you know, periodontal disease, and they did a study and tested all the family members. And microbiologically, it was different, right? So they did swabs, they're taking it, and what they found was that the dogs itself had the same strain. So the kids, you know, I guess the second phase of the dog or rolling around with them were contaminated by the dog, or they were nursing on the dog or something. But so they actually called wives, lovers, and dogs. That's kind of another gross picture up there. Maybe some of my old girlfriends, but I don't want to say my wife's here. Anyhow, so the moral of that story is you never want to suck face with this, okay? That's for sure. That's Henry. And you don't want to suck face with Darla, the Easter bulldog. Oof, good-looking girl. So there were studies done in the United States, the prevalence of adult Americans, you know, the adults 30 years and older, full mouths. They did all kinds of testing, kind of cool stuff. And the bottom line, they found about 47% of this group had some form of periodontal disease, bone loss, et cetera, 47%. And that translated to about 65 million people. Well, with 65 million people, I mean, our dental offices should be like swamped to death. But as you well know, with periodontal disease, I mean, it's like the most, you know, quiet, deadly type of disease. You don't feel it. And this is part of the problem that people, you know, oh, clean it up. You know, they did all different types of kind of cool stuff as far as measuring pockets, et cetera, et cetera. And, but, you know, why didn't they see these people come to the dentist? Well, you know, really just they didn't understand. They don't know. They don't feel it. It doesn't hurt. And, you know, a lot of our patients, what, come in when something hurts or is broken, right? So with more education we're trying to do, you know, and the belief in good health starts in the oral cavity, that might make a difference. But, you know, is it really working? Well, that's the value of patient education. This is why we love our hygienists so much, because you're out there, you have to educate these people. Especially they understand how important longevity and health and wellness is, keeping their oral cavity clean, keeping it healthy and functioning the right way. So etiology, you know, we're all infected. It's just a matter of what's growing in your oral cavity at that particular time. What that environment is going to allow things to grow. So there are really two criteria for periodontal disease. You have to have a pathogenic microflora, pathogenic environment. You have to have a susceptible host, of course. And that's about a 75% disease prevalence. But genetic mutations, I don't know. Things change. Genes change within bacteria. They change in the environment itself. Not really, but what it really boils down to is an obliging host, an immune system that allows it to take over. And it's very interesting how that does. It's the immune response, how the body reacts to that immune response, which carries the day, ultimately. We initiate the inflammation, infection from the bacteria itself, but it's the immune response of our body, how our body reacts to it, that actually does the damage. So immunologically, we're acting stupid, and that does the damage. And we'll get into those details in a little bit. So, you know, health versus periodontal disease, you know, health is what? You know, we talk about the bugs, gram-positive. It's a staining methodology. The aerobic, they like oxygen. Okay, those are the ideal bugs. Few white blood cells in there. That means a low inflammatory response. No spirochetes, which we'll get into those in detail. Those are interesting little creatures. And really, a lot of things aren't moving around. So in our biofilm, okay, which we call black, you know, dominated by gram-positive bacteria itself. And we talk about biofilm because this is the real key. We used to call, you know, plaque, but now it really is, we're considering it biofilm, a reflection of that environment. So biofilm is where all the bugs live. They love it. They love hanging out there. It's a beautiful place. They build condos, high-rises, split ranches, streets they build. They have garbage disposal itself. All the things, you know, these bugs that live within us, okay, they have one thing over top of us. They all speak the same language. Cytokine, the chemical language of biology. They find a great niche to live in. Hey, they send out chemicals. Hey, everybody and their brother moves in. They get organized. They share. If they get too crowded, they'll naughty things to each other. Okay, they use us against each other. But once again, they speak that, and it's a great environment. Think about being a bug and living in the oral cavity. It's dark. It's wet. Ooh, lots of good food coming in. It's a beautiful place to live. That is for sure. So the non-pathogens, you know, the biofilms, typical species, are predominantly gram-positive aerobes. I'm not going to waste our time going there, but Streptococcus, Variola, Actinomyces, Rothia dentacarosa. So those are those gram-positive types. And you don't see a lot of white blood cells, which we're going to show you in a few minutes, okay? So we know that for periodontal health or good ecology within itself. And the differences are, you know, with disease, there are gram-dominantly gram-negative anaerobic, many white blood cells, because the immune system is coming in to try to arrest this issue, but they start doing naughty things themselves, many spirochetes, and a highly mobile environment in there. A lot of things are going on in that environment itself. So the pathogenic biofilms, the typical species, predominantly gram-negative. And we can see these are what's called Saransky's red group. They sort of break these groups in, which we'll touch on, but a lot of them are spirochetes themselves. These color groups are based on who lives together, who's predominantly together, and the level of pathogenicity associated with them. And we can see the rest of this type of environment. So these are reflections of the ecology, the environment in and around the dentition itself and the periodontium. So we can see the environment changes over time as it becomes more pathogenic. And we see the body responding in an inflammatory way. Whether it's good or bad, that's the big question itself. So pathogens are, you know, gram-negative, one exception, which is kind of interesting. This bug came out, Streptococcus micros. It's a gram-positive anaerobe, but it's a result, they're finding, as a result of inappropriate or overuse of antibiotics. So a new strain's coming out that's antibiotic resistant, and they're seeing this in a pathogen that is used because of the incomplete use of antibiotics itself. So the environments are changing. We're seeing more and more resistant forms itself. So what are biofilms themselves? Well, human genes, you know, are intertwined in the gene pool. Human genes are about 20,000. Intestinal flora itself has 3.3 million genes itself. And in this microbiome, which is so critical, it lines everything. You have microbes in the nose. But these microbes that are symbiotic with our relationship here in our body itself, they produce, you know, antibiotics themselves, the bacteriocin, they call it. You know, they keep the bugs down, keep a controlled, happy environment. You know, the gut microbes I touched on before, you know, support and help regulate our immune system. You know, they're highly specialized. All these different bugs within live are in our body. Healthy lungs. You need microbiologic bugs down there, okay? There are bugs everywhere, and it all depends, once again, environmentally on where they live and how they function itself. So biofilms, how many oral species? Yeah, it's constantly increasing and changing depending on the environment itself. They can change from rapidly from one, you know, from 500 to 1,000, 100 to 200 in any given moment. They find niches. There are many different bugs. Bugs, you know, within their oral cavity. There are different ones that live on the left side of the tooth. Different ones that live on the right side. Different one lives deep in the pocket. Some on top. It's all different, and they're all living symbiotically within that oral system itself. So we talked about oral biofilms. Plaque is passé, okay? It could be anything. It could be your pizza last night, mucus, microbes, whatever in there. The real key is biofilm. That's the key term today. We're talking about oral biofilm itself, and people are coming to understand that more and more. So living independently, bacteria are a relatively small part of our real genome. But it's the genetic potential, the changes that occur, and the byproducts of this microbiome that really affect us and come through the biofilm itself. And once again, it boils down to how the ecology, the environment changes, and how they protect themselves, which is very interesting. So when our biofilm within the oral cavity, it starts super gingivally, and then as it ebbs and flows, which we'll show you in a minute, it's heavies at the gingival margins that we can see, and then it eventually works its way down into the crevicular area and flows down there. And we can see a 3D electron microscope. And this is the organization of the biofilm that's occurring. We have these, all these bugs are working together symbiotically. You have a filament, which is actomyces. And then you see these small rods attaching to it. So it's becoming organized. It's an intelligent way these bugs are living together. An intelligent way they're coming together. Interspecies cooperation and aggregation. So biofilm historically really started back in the 77 with, Vatten came out with the term. And of course now it's so important because we're seeing biofilms in your dental units themselves. There's biofilm, by the way, biofilm in the water supplies themselves. And the U.S. National Science Foundation developed a center for biofilm at Montana State University because it's so critical. We're seeing things. Bugs just don't hang out themselves. They live in a biofilm itself. And we can see how, in this particular case, a white blood cell is getting into the biofilm, working its way, and if it can get in to disrupt that itself. So, there are a few pathogens. They're producing toxins, but it's too dilute. I mean, pathogens really don't take threshold until the biofilm itself is left undisturbed. So you can see here how the bugs start to accumulate themselves. They replicate themselves. You know, they're creating a nice environment. They're joining together. The excitement is building, And then they get to a certain critical mass where it's like, hey, there's too many of us guys around. There's too many around. We got to do something about that. And this thing called quorum sensing, where they start acting as a group and they start sending signals out. And this is where the virulence, where the byproducts, the exotoxins start to produce. Because what they're trying to do within this biofilm niche is knock off their friends. They want to separate and reduce down the population because it's competitive. They're competitive for space. They're competitive for food. So they're producing all these different toxins coming out to try to low down the competition. And they actually, believe it or not, hijack our immune system. They produce toxins that, as the white blood cells come in, they actually poison them, and they start to act in a stupid, stupid way. So they get together, and they start forming what's called pili itself, and they start to connect themselves. And this is how they start to develop the biofilm themselves. They start to connect themselves, get in a tight formation here, adjust their positions themselves. Let me go back if I can. And as they start to move together and getting tighter and tighter and tighter, things start to change. They go starting to shift from an aerobic environment, and the oxygen depletion goes down. Now we're shifting into a different ecosystem, into an oxygen-deprived system. So as we know, dental biofilm is what we call dental plaque, right? So if you took bacteria out of the biofilm, it's at least 1,000 times, in a biofilm, bacteria in a biofilm is 1,000 times or more resistant to antibiotics than the same bacteria stripped from the biofilm. Remember, to break up or get rid of any kind of pathogenic forms in the biofilm, you have to get through what? The biofilm itself. So let's say they took a look at a biofilm. This was done at the University of Montana. This is actually oral microbes. They put into like a petri dish. And they start to get organized. They're sending out signals. They're sending the cytokines out there. They're organizing. They're starting to produce all the different polysaccharides necessary to create a niche that they're happy in and happy to live in. But if the neighborhood gets too crowded, things start to change. See some of the spirochetes starting to come in. An interesting thing is that they're looking at now is that as the environment changes, so do the, let's call the bacteria change structurally. It's called pleomorphism. Environmentally, they start to change, they turn genes on, and actually structurally change. Because they're wondering, well, you have an inoculation of X amount of things. As the environment changes, they change also. Where do these bugs come from? Nowhere? No, there's a possibility that these bacteria themselves, based on the ecology, actually change their shape and morph into something a little bit different. As you can see, the biofilm's forming very well here. So for us to be successful therapeutically, we have to get through that biofilm first. And we have to use agents to break up the biofilm, okay, whether mechanically or chemically, to get in there, break the biofilm up so we can get rid of, let's say, the pathogenic forms that are there. This is your head. Think about it. Kiss me, you fool. Can I have 80 million bugs, please? Anyhow, so how do they grow? Well, it's very thin. They stack on themselves. I mean, basically, it's the stack is about the size of three white blood cells themselves. And the sheer force, it just ebbs and it flows, which I'll show you in a second. And it diffuses into every pocket within a few minutes itself. It's very viscous, but the outer layer of the biofilms tend to shed off. But still, the main flow, the tsunami itself, really stays within the bacteria. The point of view of the bacterium, they're in a tsunami, just floating along, a nice big wave of goo going into your head. So biofilms move through the crevicular fluid itself. I go back a little bit. Let's try that again. I'm getting used to these little, there we go, these cool little videos. So this is biofilm just ebbing and flowing along. And that's what you'll see microscopically. You'll see that, steady flow of biofilm. Nothing too crazy going on. Let's try that again. There we go. And we can see here just the sheer creep of the biofilm sliding and moving along. So how fast do bacteria grow? Well, I don't know, it's amazing how they come up with the calculations. So one guy sat down and counted 100 billion microbes, and that took him a little while, and it divided by 24. So every, really, 4.8 hours that the population actually doubles within the microbiologic world. Oh, there we go, it actually worked. So when you're looking under the microscope itself, which we'll get into in a few minutes, when you see this kind of activity, this is kind of, if you want to call it healthy biofilm, then not all biofilm is bad. Biofilm is important, okay? But it's a nice steady state. This is where disease comes in. We see a lot of highly moving, high mobility of the tissue, of the biofilm itself. So in a Petri dish, in E. coli, under ideal conditions, okay, this is how quickly microbes multiply. Okay, every 15 to 20 minutes, they double over on themselves. So when you're thinking about it, what we try to do is really disrupt and just destroy the biofilm, okay? So that's what we're trying to do. It's oral hygiene is what? Breaking up and disorganizing the biofilm itself. And we keep doing that to maintain a state of wellness and health within the oral cavity. And the regrowth is really based upon the host defenses themselves. So there's a consistent biofilm disruption. That's how we control periodontal disease. And we'll get into that a little bit. So when we talk about major pathogenic groups in periodontal care, this is where Soransky came in, where they have these red groups, these different colored groups, and those are really based on the pathogenicity and also the tendency for these found within the same niche itself. So the polymorphonus, tannerella, and treptomonas dentcola are really the highest pathogenic forms. And there's probably tons and tons more that we just don't even understand themselves. So it really, those pathogens really upregulate the immune system itself and put out a lot of cytokines and inflammation. And they actually gain control of our immune system. They actually use our white blood cells against their friends down in the pockets themselves. So it promotes, you know, diapersesis, which is really the movement of the white blood cells out of the uvascular system into the pockets themselves. And they, what they do is also prevent, which is kind of interesting, all these different chemical reactions, how they're controlling our immune system. The chemotaxis is really a trail set up. It's almost like ants setting up a trail for their friends to find a piece of sugar. White blood cells do that in the environment itself. They inhibit that. They inhibit that. So they're controlling the white blood cells within the environment itself. So that's the red. And then you have these orange group, okay? Prevotella, I'm not even getting into the names itself, but they find those in the orange group. And these are unique. Red and orange groups are very unique themselves. They're tissue invasive type of pathogens. They get into the tissue itself, and this is where the deeper inflammation really comes about. They upregulate the cytokines and trigger that innate immunity, which is all what? The neutrophils, et cetera. That first line of macrophages within the tissue itself, their innate immunity itself. And they trigger that immune system. That's competitive inhibition. So our yellow groups and our green groups have become less pathogenic, we see, and then our purple groups themselves. So this is how they are really organizing the bugs themselves based on pathogenicity and the tendency for them to live within the same ecosystem at the same time itself. So these are all getting organized. They're not very pathogenic, but once again, what's happening is as that oxygen tension starts to drop, the environment's changing, they're pooping and peeing in you, and it becomes more acidic, and this is where they start to shift back to that red and orange area itself. And this is one of the kind of outliers. It's not found in many pathogenic biofilms, but you know, you see this type of bacteria in very rapidly advancing cases of periodontal disease themselves. And they used to call it juvenile periodontitis. So that's one of the pathogens that contribute to that. So what happens is that these more pathogenic forms infiltrate into the periodontal sulcus itself, into the tissue itself. Okay? And right there, those are the spirochetes. So they invade the tissue itself. So those are the spirochetes found. And these are invasive species. They're going into the tissue itself. The significance is that with the periodontal disease itself, once the invasion comes, okay, we're getting invasion of the tissue, which is different where it's sitting in the pocket, okay, the less pathogenic forms, the symbiotic forms, these pathogenic forms are now invading the tissue itself. They become a reservoir for infection, okay, they can reinfect themselves even though we clean them up, and this is where we're seeing the inflammatory components spread throughout the entire body in the bloodstream, the systemic disease coming from the oral cavity, from those invasive invasive pathogenic forms. So basically the periodontal pathogens that are found in the coronary arteries and other sites, and we talked about the problems with periodontal disease. These are the invasive forms that are creating stroke. It's all about inflammation associated with these bugs. And those oral spirochetes are finding in the brains of Alzheimer's victims. There are no barriers here, no barriers. And rheumatoid arthritis, et cetera, associated with different type of inflammatory diseases. So it's really, it's the bugs, yes, but it's our body's response to them that's doing the damage to our body and how we respond to them itself. So systemic disease associated with periodontal disease, cardiovascular, adverse pregnancies, low birth weights, peripheral artery disease, osteoporosis, diabetes, you name it, periodontal disease contributes. But if you look at these are associated with what? Inflammatory processes. Our body's response to this deeper infection coming out of the oral cavity itself. It's an immune response, okay? Simplified, the immune response, we have a passive innate system, which are our skin, our barriers, the epithelial cells being closely knit together, our normal flora, commensal flora, okay? They protect us. That's why probiotics are so important. You know, our mantra at our school is the weed, feed, and seed our gut. You're constantly putting probiotics in. You're constantly protecting yourself from invasion of these pathogenic forms. Normal flora, supporting the flora, temperature, pH, how our immune system responds, and of course the antigenic response and all those cytokines, that information traveling throughout the system itself. When we get into an active, okay, responsive, then we're talking about T cells, identifying ourselves, chemotaxis, you know, diapersis, where the cells are migrating out of the endothelium, the blood vascular system, and of course our favorite, our B cells, which create those antibodies itself. The interesting thing about the entire immune system is that when the immune system is functioning properly and engulfs these bacteria forms, we always thought it was these enzyme systems that actually broke down the bacteria, killed them, and then eventually the white blood cells poops them out. It was actually the immune system, the basis for killing bugs and even antibodies is based on ozone. Our body kills the bugs by using ozone, creating ozone through a water catalytic pathway, and that's kind of cool. We'll talk about that a little down the road. So when we talk about polymorphonucleites, neutrophils, et cetera, and early gingivitis, the first 7 to 10 days, you know, the white blood cells migrate out. They're starting to recognize and flank, you know, the infection in there. They leave their molecular trail. Things are functioning properly, are getting faked out. They phagocytose all the bugs, eat them up, digest them, kill them with some ozone, and then poop out the products and eventually get it out of the system. But they're also producing all different type of enzyme systems. Enzyme systems, breaking down collagen and elastin are the supporting structures of your matrix itself. So, and then, you know, the typical white blood cell, you know, neutrophil would last about 3 days and then it pops. It just gets worn out itself. But what happens is that when it breaks up, it starts to dump its own enzymes out, and that creates basically an inflammatory response. It starts to damage the tissue from the inflammation of the cell breaking down. Now, the interesting thing is when the mitochondrial DNA actually intensifies the immune response, because guess what? Mitochondria were once bacteria that got into our tissue and produced a lot of energy for us. So mitochondria are actually a bacterial species within our cells. So it's kind of interesting. Once again, that symbiotic relationship. And when they are distributed and dropped into the system itself, they dump enzymes, and that creates a lot of problems associated with inflammation itself. And it boils down to inflammation itself. So with your initial colonization, you have, which is not resolved with 7 to 10 days, you start to get an inflammatory response itself. And all these different type of genes start to kick in. And this is why, once again, we talked about earlier, how the bacteria start to get overcrowded. They hijack our immune system to clear out the population. There's an innate intelligence deeper down there that we're starting to understand that they're using our own system to go get the population down when it becomes overloaded itself, which is pretty amazing, okay? And, you know, we get old genes going on. We have an influx of actually impotent white blood cells aren't functioning right. They're poison. And they start to, break up. And there's tons and tons of enzyme systems coming in to the system that are actually getting that inflammation and congestion within the epithelial cells itself, in the pockets itself. And once again, we see that mitochondria effect when they're breaking down, creating more and more inflammation. It's like a snowball in hell going on here. And it's all driven by the intelligence of those bacteria. Okay, so we move in a couple of weeks, you have a more mature biofilm. This is when the immune system starts to upregulate a little bit, get those B cells and T cells coming in. Now we're getting an active immune response. Inflammation ramps up, the epithelium migrates, walling off the infection, is starting to hold this infection, recognize it at a deeper level itself. And then within 3 weeks, we have a mature biofilm. Continual inflammation. It's really getting deep in there, producing a lot of enzyme systems, a lot of toxins are pouring out, and upregulation. And this is when, all of a sudden, for some reason, we're poisoning the system, and the system's not correctly. The bad information's come in, like I talked about before, biologically, and we start to see the bone degeneration and a breakdown of all the supporting collagen and the supporting structures. So as it starts to develop, you can see the maturity, inflammation rank rolls up. But interesting enough, this is controlled by the bugs that live there. They're putting out this information. They're actually poisoning the white blood cells to act in an idiotic way to keep their ecology functioning at the level they like to. So I don't know who's smarter than who, which is kind of a different way of thinking. And this is where we get our bone loss. So it's really, with periodontal disease now, we're starting to think more in terms of it's how our immune system responds to these pathogenic forms, responds to this ecological shift that really does the damage to us. So we can keep the ecology healthy and symbiotic, we won't get that stupid immune response and the bone and connective tissue damage, which you typically see. So in quick review, it's biofilm, not plaque. All biofilms, you brush your teeth at night, guess what? The next morning, you got a lot of biofilm in there, you know? Are not pathogenic, it depends on who's there and how long it's around. The bugs are smart, okay? Periodontal disease is not a microbial infection, but inflammation does the damage. So once again, we have to start thinking differently. Now we're thinking, okay, we got to keep the mouth clean. We do all our beautiful hygiene work. But also, can we maintain a nice microbial environment that's conducive to health? Because microbes themselves, the good ones, produce a lot of great things. They work with our system itself. We really need them. But as the infection slipping and becomes more mature, the biofilm becomes more mature, that's when we get that stupid inflammatory response. As we know, periodontal inflammation increases the risk of systemic inflammation throughout the entire body. And the microbiology of health and disease are vastly, vastly different, as we've seen. Okay, so we have a sense of we're dealing with bugs, we're dealing with ecology, we're dealing with biology. We have to keep things clean, but okay. Based on this, let's talk about how do we diagnose, treat, and maintain and prevent these issues from progressing to an environment or ecology that's not conducive to health and wellness. So the standard of care has always been risk assessments. You know, what did patients do? You know, what's their history? You know, prophies, education, home care, microscopic analysis, which we'll look at, DNA analysis now, the Banahan test, DNA, irrigation, you know, root planting, scaling, supplementation, nutritional support for the patient itself, pocket reduction procedures, which, you know, are not too fun to say the least, you know, frequent recall appointments, laser therapies, and now, of course, oxygen ozone therapy itself. The interesting thing that's always kind of bugged me about with taking care of perio is these recall appointments. When I was in dental school for years, it was always 3 and 6 months was the answer to everything. 3 and 6 months. I'm not sure if that's just an insurance agent thing or what. But now we really customize everyone's recall based on their specific needs. And we have patients that come in every couple of months. That patients come in every 3 months, 4 months. It all depends, once again, on what their specific needs are, regardless of what the insurance says. Okay. So diagnostic concepts. Well, we've been, you know, putting a stick in everybody's pocket forever, right? Measuring, you know, pocket depth, absolutely. You know, pockets, you know, greater than 3 millimeters should be considered at greater risk because it's a micro niche that, once again, how well does the patient keep it clean? And we have to monitor, you know, those changes over time. So, you know, cool things like the Florida probe is always nice educationally. But ultimately, we have to go back and measure around. You know, every patient loves getting stuck with the stick 85,000 times. That's always entertaining for them. Okay? Tissue tone, you know, periodontal tissue should be firm and pink. I mean, I'm talking to the choir here, you know. Swelling and blood, you know, are clinical signs of periodontal disease, obviously. And it could be other disorders. I mean, when you think about it today, I mean, people are taking so many crazy drugs when they come in. You know, they come in with a bag of drugs or other, you know, in our practice, patients come in with bag loads of supplements. Okay, bag loads of supplements. I said, well, you know, why are you taking that? Well, it looks good. You know, one of the big questions you always ask your patients, what kind of herbals are you taking? Remember, herbals are what? They're like medicine, okay? They're taken for a specific purpose. You don't live on herbals. It's like, I've taken echinacea for 6 months. Well, 5.5 months ago, it stopped working. you know, it's boost your immune system, it's done. But you have to be careful on what these, you know, patients are always taking today. Always ask them about what's your supplementation. What kind of herbals are you taking? Are you doing any detoxification procedures? These are all influencing and have an effect on our friend, the epithelial cell and the matrix, et cetera, and the ecology itself. So prescriptions, hormone effects, you know, and a good history. What have you been doing? What's your health history? Are you dealing, you know, battling, you know, a chronic disease? You know, have you been to the dentist in the last 10 years or so? So those are important things, the tissue tone, et cetera. And, of course, you know, the classical bleeding upon probing. If it's bleeding, there's inflammation, you know. The blood cells, you know, become more fragile, endothelium's breaking down. We got that whole congestion thing going on, and we see inflammation going on, and there's toxins in there, so bloody itself. And if it stinks, I mean, have you had patients come in like, whoa, they leave the operatory, it's still bad? We all been there, right? It's unbelievable. It's like, man, oh, man. So open up the windows, get the fan going. They are fermenting. Now, when you think about it, if they're fermenting that much in their oral cavity, what the hell is going on in the rest of their body? Because remember, we are but one. And if that oral cavity is like that, what is their GI tract like? Or it's like, you know, one of our questions we ask, I always tell every year, I'd say this. I said, well, we're interviewing the patient. Do you poop every day? And they go like, is this a medical office or something, dental? It's important, you know, to defecate every day. And, you know, we're right outside Manhattan. You know, we have patients come in. Oh, I go once a week. Oh, really? I have patients come in once every 2 weeks. Hey, man, you're full of shit. You know what I mean? And they start to stink like that. I mean, you got... Your bowel's got to, you know, you got to empty out the tube, man. And it just keeps on backing up. I said, you ever feel something pushing against your throat or something after a couple of weeks? My Lord. No wonder they're fermenting. You know, you have to get it out. Get things moving. Nothing a good enema wouldn't cure. Right, Barb? There you go. I know Lude likes those, right? All right. So anyhow, so you got a fermentation process going on. We know that. Okay, so if they stink, there's a problem, all right? And, of course, recession of the gums, you know, abfractions, loss of, you know, recession there. Is it really an occlusal problem? It could be. You know, the occlusal problem doesn't create the periodontal disease. It contributes to it, that's for sure. And here we're doing some ozone desensitization of roots, which really works really, really, really well itself. And, of course, you know, connective tissue destruction, bone loss, we see that. And really, once again, you have to assess the patient. Is this bone loss from a previous experience? Is it active? What's going on at that particular moment going on? So we lose that bone, that degeneration, the osteoclastic activity in there, the chronic inflammation, the stupidity of our poison cells destroying ourselves. So microbiologic testing itself. So let's see if this works.
Percent of adults in the United States over the age of 30 have some form of gum disease. That's 93 million Americans. Based on U.S. statistics, it is shocking to realize that worldwide, 1.8 billion people suffer from some sort of periodontal disease. Even in healthy, athletic people, bacteria that cause gingivitis and periodontal disease can travel anywhere in the body and are shown to be associated with heart disease, stroke, and diabetes in the same way smoking is associated with cancer. It is a silent killer. So what's the cause and how can it be eliminated? Up to 600 types of bacteria can live in the mouth. Among these, only about 20 are bad. These pathogens live below the gum line. They grow very fast, doubling in number every 5 hours. They hijack our immune system, causing it to destroy our gum tissue instead of the pathogens. The pathogens feed on this destruction and get into the bloodstream, where they cause life-threatening inflammation in other organs, like the heart, the lungs, and the brain.
we use the phase microscope to determine if someone is at risk for or has active periodontal disease. We take a sample of the bacteria from under your gum, and we look at that under a slide under the phase microscope, and we can see a live picture of the bacteria. If there's a lot of movement, we know that person is at high risk for dental disease. If they don't do something to eliminate that cause, they will get destruction in their mouth. You have a choice. You can spend hundreds of dollars treating the cause of dental disease, or you can spend many thousands of dollars treating the results of periodontal disease. Which one would you choose? A dentist who doesn't have a microscope is kind of blind.
Most dentists are neither diagnosing the disease correctly nor treating it correctly. Gum disease infections have been linked to diabetic infections, to joint infections, to Alzheimer's disease, to at least a dozen or more systemic diseases.
Periodontal disease is a bacterial infection that can be treated. Our treatment identifies pathogenic bacteria, and we can determine what needs to be done to eliminate them. We do everything possible to make sure that you keep your teeth.
Ask your dentist for a microident bacteria test to help the dentist identify the cause of the problem. Bacteria are the root cause of gum disease, and microident identifies the 11 most aggressive and destructive bacteria. You need to treat the cause of the problem, not just the symptoms.
Understanding the bacteria and being able to use bacteria testing such as microident, that helps us know the cause, not just the symptom. You want your dentist looking for things that you're not aware of, because by the time you're aware of them, they're already a pretty big problem. And that's why we call it a silent killer.
You should ask your dentist if he does any microbiological testing for pathogens or bad bacteria. And if he doesn't do any testing for bad bacteria, you should find someone who does.
For more information, go to the website on this video.
I get so choked up when I see that movie.
I tell we can thank Bill Landis because he helped me with a lot of these slides, which are pretty awesome. So let's talk about the phase contrast microscope a little bit today, because this is a really wonderful tool for patient education. Also, you get a sense of what's going on in the oral cavity itself. So the phase contrast microscope is really, it's cost effective for risk evaluation. It's a method to determine, you know, the immune status. We're seeing a lot of white blood cells coming in, and we can really determine the wide range of the putative periodontal pathogens, and we can really see what's going on there. You see all the kind of creepy crawlers that are going down in and around that periodontal pocket itself. Now, in the real true world of microbiology, we don't know what the hell's going on there, because a lot of times as you remove a sample from the pocket itself, things change dramatically. This oxygen surface tension changes. So we lose a lot of the pathogens, but we still get a really good assessment of this. And especially when you put it up on a little monitor and the patient sees, they go, ooh, you know, what's growing in there? So the advantage is really, you know, it's chair side. It takes, just a minute to do. We can look for white blood cells, which I'll show you in a second. That's an indication of the level of inflammation associated. And we can see spirochetes in there. That's what you really don't want to see. And, of course, it's a great patient motivator. And this is great for our hygienists to do. And it's cheap. It's, you know, like 25 cents a test. But you have to invest a few bucks. First of all, you have to get into a little bit of a learning curve, do a little studying about microbiology, which is important to understand what's there, and invest in a microscope, phase contrast, or even a dark field would work. Okay? So, you know, we can see different types of bacteria in there that are really markers for a really aggressive periodontal infection itself. So one of the primary ones are Dentacola, which I'll show you in a minute. And those are really associated more the aggressive type of pathogens in these periodontal pockets. So with the microscope itself, you know, we can do the risk assessment itself, and we look for different things. As we look on the left here, this is kind of the typical, you know, quiescent, if you want to call it, biofilm, where all the microbes in there are happy, they're symbiotic, they're producing nice things, they're living together happily. But as we look to the right, where we saw all that activity itself, that really becomes more of a pathogenic look within the system itself, okay? This is where we're starting to see spirochetes and a disease state. So that's where the patient motivation really comes in, seeing the difference on the two. And the phase microscope was developed, you know, back a number of years. Physician, you know, a mathematician, Fritz Zenke, and he won a Nobel Prize in 1953 for developing optics in this area. But the beauty of the microscope itself, it's really optical staining. You know, typically when I was in anatomy school, we did a lot of histology. You know, eosin, hemosin, eosin, et cetera, hematoxylin. But here it's kind of like an optical stain. The problem with when you use typical stains, histologic stains, they're very toxic and they kill everything. Here we're really looking at a live sampling itself. So they are very transparent, but when you chart the phase contrast actually puts the wavelengths of light out of phase slightly, and that allows us to really see what's going on microscopically, clearly. So it's really an optical stain that we're using itself. So it's a very simple procedure. I want to thank Bill Landis for these slides and then helping this lecture. And basically, it's a slide. You aura prep it. You make your samples, cover glass, and just seal it up. I'll go through the procedure. So it's really simple. First of all, obviously, never you reuse the same slides. Okay, that's dopey. You know, handle by the edges. You don't want to contaminate it. Use a glove. You know, cover glass is very thin, and you know, it's idiosyncratic. Anyhow. What's important is that when you're doing these slides is that you don't use like saline or anything else. It has to really be, you know, isotonic, and that's where that aura prep really comes in. It really extends the life of the sample, proper pH, so you're preventing lysis of the cells themselves. And never use distilled water. Obviously, it's hypotonic itself. Normal saline is hypertonic. And the problem with, you know, same salt, you know, is isotonic. You know, saline goes in and out. We preserve the pathogens themselves. Well, the microbiologic sample itself. You know, that water flow is zero. Hypertonic. You know, salt on the outside of the cell is going to crenate it. You know, squish it out. So you get crenation itself. Hypotonic. Basically, lower salt on the outside. Okay, it just makes the cell suck water in there and becomes hypotonic itself with its salt, you know, from the on the other side, water flows into the cell itself. Okay, so basically, you know, you place a drop of aura prep on the slide and biofilm, and you know, very carefully, what you do is really collect a sample from the deepest part of the pocket itself. Lift it out, try to not get any hook, any tartar in there itself. Pull the, you know, the lower third, avoid calculus inclusions, and basically just gently transfer that into that little drop of the solution itself. And, you know, there we go. We do our risk assessments, you know, pool population, risk sites, different areas of concern for yourself. And basically what you do is just take the slide itself, the cover slip over top of it, drop it down nice and easy so it spreads, flip it over, get the excess fluid out of there, and then your slide is pretty much prepped. And what you can do is we'll take what's called oral seal and just slide it around the cell and you know, the cover slip itself and then seal it itself. And then you have your slide that will last quite a period of time without any changes from the oxygen in the environment. So it really preserves everything so you get a really nice slide example there. Very simple to do. And let it set for a few minutes. Let your sample here. And your focal plane is basically your optics going up and down in this thin little area here, which is great. So, risk factors we look at. We look for white blood cells, spirochetes, yeast, trichomonas, which you're going to really love, and amoeba. And red blood cells. So, you know, you're going to see epithelial cells in there, which you'll see here, looking through there. That you're going to naturally pick up as you scave the inside of the pocket itself, those epithelial cells. And this would be your basically low risk. Biofilm itself, you don't see many white blood cells, really no spirochetes themselves. So spirochetes are really the problem. You see spirochetes come in multiple forms. You'll see them. they're loosely, they're nascent, or they become more coordinated. And once again, these are organized, these are intelligent. They start to gang up on each other. They hook onto rods. They become filaments in there. And these are your spirochetes getting well organized. They are smart. See a spirochete, then what's called quorum sensing. Once again, they're talking to each other. These are not stupid things. They have their own world, their own intelligence. They start to activate genes. They start to work together, start producing proteins. They start to congregate together. And then you see synchronization of behavior, which is kind of interesting to see. There we go. Let's see. There we go. We start to see candida. You see the little buds, the hyphae. And of course, they have your daughter cells in here, which can be mistaken for red blood cells themselves. That's a red blood cell. You can see the little buds coming off the yeast themselves. Yeast hyphae there. It's not very exciting looking at yeast. They don't do much. They just hang out. But there you go. And a more favorite bug, this kind of thing creeps me out a little bit. Trichomonas. It's protozoan, one cell. It's similar to Trichomonas vaginalis, but they kind of can probably the same type of thing. And they find you find these more mature pathogenic biofilms themselves right there. There we go. See them right in the middle. There they are. Some amoebas right in there. Kiss me, you fool. There we go. I used to see this stuff when we used to do when we were kids. Used to get, you know, a jug of water, put some grass or something in there, and grow stuff in a jar and take a look, and realize maybe that's where the term jarhead came from. I'm not sure, but you can see this activity here. He's going around scavenging, having dinner, poking at you, undulating membrane. Nice. Oof. An amoeba. Now, this is always very exciting. Always love this when, you know, Bill Landers here, he sets up at Oratech. Awesome. He sets up a microscope. And, of course, an unwitting dentist, you know, kind of first or second time comes in a meeting, has a sample taken, and God forbid they have an amoeba. Everybody, the entire organization, everybody has to go see this poor person with their amoeba. And they sit there, contaminated. Let's see how our amoeba works. Pretty amazing with these creatures. And they're tough. I mean, they're tough to get rid of. And this is why we like using ozone so much in dentistry, especially in perio, because it's so awesome. Because these things, you know, the trichomonas, these amoeba forms, and these other pathogenic forms, you know, like I told you, they invade the tissue. So you go there, you clean out the pocket, you rinse it out with whatever disinfecting agent. But the problem is it doesn't get into the tissue, where if you bubble ozone gas down in that pocket, it turns into peroxides and has an electrical charge. These are all these pathogens carry a positive electrical charge as an inflammation. So those peroxides will track these things down in the tissue itself and kill them, which is really, really important. So you can see, you know, the amoeba itself can be mistaken for, I think, a white blood cell, like a neutrophil. But, you know, they're just scooting around. So you can see here another amoeba. And what happens is that the amoebas actually attack and eat white blood cells, neutrophils. You can see some of these will be packed with white blood cells themselves as they engulf them through pinocytosis. So once again, we start to look at these slide samples coming off the microscope itself, and we're looking for white blood cells. That's a big indication of inflammation. So we can get a good sense of periodontal disease by the number of white blood cells responding, whether they're dopey or not. So let's take a look at that. Let me go back. There we go. And this is a white neutrophil in here. And the difference between this, so you don't mistake it with a amoeba cell, you see a lot of dancing granules in here. So the trick is with the microscope, it's just a matter of getting in there, getting samples, and just practicing, spending the time on the microscope and looking. Once again, you can see all the dancing microbes. When you see a lot of white blood cells within your sample, you know you have an advanced periodontal condition, a lot of inflammation there. So when we have tissue trauma from infection, inflammation, you know, we're going to get a lot of cytokines coming up. You're going to get vascular permeability. We see that the vascular lymphatic congestion, things are going to be leaking out. And, of course, you're going to get a lot of neutrophils flooding into the area as a result of that. So let's see another cool video if this works. There you go. Those are white blood, red blood cells. I'm sorry. You can see them right here. I won't waste time on the video for this. Red blood cells. Okay. Quiz. All right, Bill. Bill Virtue, you have to answer these questions. What is this bug? Earthworm. Earthworm. No, I'm again. It's one of our favorite. Heliobacter pylorus. Everybody thinks about Heliobacter pylorus. That's a commensal bacteria, believe that. It's normally found in the stomach and normally found in great numbers in what? The oral cavity itself. But when it becomes, once again, the environment changes, the ecology changes, that's when they become virulent and they're associated with ulcers. So we all have this Heliobacter pylorus, but once again, environmentally, ecologically, when things come out of balance, that's when they become a pathogenic form. Oral cavity, well, you know, we've lost the reservoir for that, Heliobacter. So the microscope is awesome. You see kind of the cool things. It's a nice tool, especially for a hygiene, to spend the time educating the patient on what's going on in their oral cavity. And you use the microscope continuously throughout the treatment to see the changes within the patient himself. And of course, you know, beyond that, if, you know, things aren't changing, then you can get into actually DNA testing itself and cultural tests. You know, it's always interesting with infections. You know, with periodontal disease, typically, what have we been doing? Pocket probing, bleeding, blah, 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 and then cleaning it up. In medicine, there's an infection. They take cultures all the time. And we're starting to do that in dentistry a little bit more. Another very nice test is called BANA testing. It's an enzyme test. And basically what the BANA enzyme does is really, it's per periodontal risk, another assessment tool. It's very quick and expensive. And it's another, it really tests those red groups themselves, another testing methodology, once again, to educate the patient and have good records associated with that. Chair side, it takes a couple of minutes to do. It detects those red groups, all those, you know, Treptomonia denticola we talked about, you know, those, that group there. Sensitive to DNA, and it's fully, really all in mag. It's very simple to do. You know, really only tests. Once again, a lot of these tests are just assessment tests. It gives you a sense because of what's really going on pathologically. And it's really colorimetric. There's no written report. And it costs about $400 to get the equipment on itself. Very simple procedure. You know, it's really as a marker, about 95.5% as accurate as complete DNA testing itself. Okay. So basically, once again, you harvest the sample. You place the sample down at the bottom of this little card itself. You moisten the, don't scrub, just wipe it on there. And you moisten the top part of the card. You fold it at the perforation. You place it within this little incubator itself, insert the strip, it cycles it 5 minutes, and then what you really have, you get rid of the bottom part, and the reaction occurs on the upper part. And what you'll see here is you'll get some testing done where these areas represent positive reactions. So, you know, when you have nothing comes up, minimal risk, and all the way up to a more positive, more effective risk. So you have some documentation, simple documentation that you can use. So the Banenzyme test. And this has been signed, there's a lot of literature out there in the Banenzyme test, the enzyme testing. So it's supported very, very well documentation-wise. You know, weak positive, you know, there's detectable microbes there, and of course, really more positive effect there. So you can test it in the beginning part of your initial examination, and you can even use a dark field microscope, which we have in our office itself. So a lot of said, a lot of support and research done with BANA testing, very, very important. Also, we can do a DNA testing. Once again, it's one of those things where you can take a saliva sample. They test for these particular bacteria, with 2, 4, 5, or 6 of them, to show, once again, as an assessment tool. It's not what everything is there, but the level, the intensity of the bacteria itself. The advantages with DNA, it's simple enough. You get multiple species, and you get an antibiotic guideline. The only problem I had with these tests were I always get the same antibiotic guideline. Does anybody do DNA testing here? Have done it with DNA? I always get the same thing, the same amount of drugs that blow the whole patient up. Anyhow, disadvantages, it's, you know, costs each patient an X amount of time. It takes a few days. And these are the companies that are actually doing that. MIAOMT, Han Diagnostics, which we use, which I like a little bit better than PerioPath. And with the oral DNA, basically you're swishing around and spitting into the tube itself, and you ship it off and get your results back, you know, basically colorimetric and basically what's going on within the oral cavity. But here, the problem with this test, which, you know, is really it's a saliva test, so I don't think you're getting into the deeper crevicular areas, which do tend to be more pathogenic itself. So the diversity is a little shaky there. And so the percentages are a little bit off here. But with the Han testing, you actually take your paper points going down into questionable areas here. And I found this to be a more effective methodology for detecting. And once again, it gives you a sense. I use the term assessment a lot because, you know, it's absolute science, but it gives us a sense of what's going down in there microbiologically. But once again, it's a reflection of that ecosystem itself. Okay. There's a lot of slides I got to get through. Anyhow, so we worry about gene expression, how things are changing, all this. But the bottom line in those testings are, it'll give you a sense of what's going on. Very simple to do. You make an offer to your patients. They want to do that. But the only problem I've had with these tests is, I always find, I don't know if anybody, like I said, does this, but I always found the same recommendation. You know, blast them away with amoxicillin, methotrexate, arrestin, chlorhexidine, all this stuff. And I'm destroying the microflora as I'm doing that. Where there are other methodologies that really change that environment and make it a little bit safer without destroying the patient's gut. Because as you know, with the antibiotic issue, as we destroy the microflora in the gut, we're also doing what? Destroying the effect of what? The immune system in the gut itself. You know, we have to be very, very careful how we use antibiotics these days. And we're always concerned about the medical and lifestyle status of the patients themselves. You know, do they have chronic disease, systemic disease, physical disabilities? Can they keep their oral cavity clean? Can we help them with that? Nutritional issues, okay? You know, the Burger King diet, that really helps with the periodontium. You know, good physical exam. There's different type of modalities we're seeing of the chronicity of the diseases reflecting in the oral cavity. And, you know, bad root canals and what's the condition of the dentition themselves. Yeah, we look here. This is one of my favorite slides that I took out an unborn cousin, or actually an unborn brother of one of my patients. This is the root tip right here, and this one was attached to a root canal. You know, you elevate it out, you bloop, and I said, holy smokes. You can see his brother's eyes and jaws right here, but those are nasty. And those things, believe me, it's just not self-contained. What the hell is going on that produces something like this in the jaw? These deeper chronic infections. Is that used to? There you go. Stu Nunley, ladies and gentlemen. Round of applause for him, though. Okay. Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. So we use all these assessment tools. I use assessment tools, all right, on these whole things to put the picture together. Okay, that's cool. We know we got an infection. We got white blood cells. We got all these weird aliens growing in your mouth. The ecosystem's all screwed up. So, well, what do we do to treat it? Well, clean it up. Okay, so your treatment options, objectives are really, and this is all IAOMT guidelines, is to disinfect the mouth and eliminate the pathogenic microorganisms, okay, change the environment, to remove as little healthy tissue as possible, meaning like in dental school, we used to take out, cut off papilla, which was always entertaining with our nice gentle cuts, touch there, remove the calculus deposits so we can get down deep into there, and ensure that the patient has a good lifestyle for good oral health. So perianal, procedures, comprehensive diagnosis, microscopic analysis, and treatment cycle dependent on the patient, okay? I mean, when I was going back to dental school, traditional was like one quadrant at a time, but, we like to clean up the house these days, And Stu, is this your bathroom during dental school? No, okay. So we really like to clean up the house as much as possible to change, disrupt that biofilm, get things moving along as best as possible, depending, once again, on how much the patient can handle. So we really like to get some of that gross stuff off. Once again, these are your typical New Jersey patients. And also, we want to get down and irrigate and get that biofilm. This is where ozone water has been shown scientifically is wonderful for breaking up biofilm. That's a wonderful non-toxic agent that we can use to disrupt the biofilm itself. So one of the first things that we do is really do what we call a sulcus pathogenic lavage. We rinse and irrigate the pockets out to break up the biofilm. What we're really doing is debulking the pockets themselves, getting that biofilm up and out. So when we go in there mechanically, we're really not, dumping tons of stuff into someone whose body is possibly compromised immunologically. Okay, so we're not dumping all that stuff in the system indirectly. So we're really lavaging in ozone water or any non-toxic agent that break up that biofilm and debulk those pockets of all those biofilm that we can do. And our favorite, the American Dental Association, really shown that periodontal disease is a classic biofilm disease. The only way you break up biofilm is a strong oxidizing agent to break up that biofilm itself. And we found ozone is extraordinarily good at that. Research has supported that, where you have distilled water being flushed across microbial bodies there. You have ozonated water. We start to see, changes within the membranes. Within 2 minutes of just using ozonated water, we have total disruption of the bacterial membranes themselves, just ozonated water. You can't be allergic to ozonated water. It's impossible. But the beauty of it also, with the studies have shown, that ozone itself, ozonated water, just washes away the biofilm. Because you can take antibiotics and the cows come home, you can do all kinds of stuff, but if you don't get through the biofilm, you can't get through to the bugs below. So you have to get that biofilm washed away and get to the bugs themselves. And we can see here, fluorescent microscopic analysis, distilled water, no effect. Green represents cell death. And we can see just ozonated water, what's called low microdose, was extremely, extremely effective as far as killing the bugs and breaking up the biofilm itself. So, mechanical debridement, get up there, root planing used to be a big thing. Remember in dental school or even hygiene school where you root planed and scaled, right? And the professor would come by, take the little mirror and explore, and just slide up and down the squeaky root. Oh, I think I find a little roughness there. Well, if we root planed forever, we'd have great teeth with no necks attached to them. So root planing is really out these days, and really it's just really getting the roots as clean as possible and then cleaning up those pockets itself. So scaling is great, but we don't like to root plane too much, even though we probably do that. And of course, once again, having the patient being kind of the co-therapist. Once again, if they don't go home and clean their teeth, It's always amazing. We can do all this beautiful stuff. Oh, God, wow, look how I did. Cleaned up those gums, ozone, this, that, all these kind of formulations. But if they don't go home and keep it clean, it means nothing, right, Greg? That's it. You got to do their homework. So home care instructions are important, you know, reinforced each time. I mean, I'm talking to the choir here, but, you know, positive reinforcement, and the patient has to be meticulous if possible. And that's one of our things we always talk about. We do, oh, this wonderful bridge work, veneers, oh, this is fantastic. But you know what? I tell them, if you don't treat it like fine jewelry, keep it clean, it's going to fail within a number of years. So keep it clean. Break up that biofilm. We have all kinds of cool tools out there. They have different oral rinses, you know, PerioClear, tooth and gum tonic, which we love. I love those little interproximal brushes. Those are fantastic. You know, floss. What was it? Just a few months ago, somebody got it and said floss sucks or something like that. I think everybody had a heart attack with that one. But I tell you, we found the little proxy brushes so much more useful than flossing. You know, the proxy brushes come in all different types. You ever hear the product Pixters at all? Familiar with those? Check it out. Those are awesome because they come in all different sizes. As far as keeping bridge work and prosthetics and just keeping teeth clean, those are great little brushes to get in there. So you have all kinds of tools to keep things clean. You know, home care, irrigation. Irrigation is not rinsing, okay? One of the cool things is like a home irrigator or a tech has these. We can get down and irrigate into those pockets, keep that clean. Once again, you can use your different type of or rinses, and some people love to use iodine. Just make sure you don't have a thyroid issue going on. But another thing my dear wife came up with here, found was like an oral irrigator for your shower you can attach. So you can irrigate everything, attach it right to the shower head, and have them irrigate the pockets right in the shower. The complete clean body. Okay. And, we, you know, home care, you know, we can do oil pulling is a big thing, coconut oil, traditional oil pulling has been sesame seed oil. I mean, I have patients, I don't know how they keep the oil in there for 20 minutes. You know, it's just kind of soak it around. Just put it in your coffee, that works. Now, actually, oil pulling is good. One of the most important things as far as nutrients, make sure they start getting decent vitamins and supplements. Another critical element I tell you we really found success with was having the patients get on trace minerals. That's really, really important, supporting and nurturing the epithelium. Marco Farmer makes a wonderful formula called Somaplex 21. Wonderful trace element formula it takes with patients, really supports it well. You know, different herbal, you know, ginseng, peppermint, chamomile tea. You can do poultices, you know, and just kind of like an anti-inflammatory tart. Calendula extract works. You can get that from Bioton. Calendula is great. Also, another trick is that we found that with like colloidal silver in a spray, that's another fine thing. All these little tricks that you can do to elevate the patient's consciousness as far as oral hygiene is concerned is really great. And of course, antioxidant green teas. And turmeric, people should love turmeric, man. That turmeric is great, fantastic. You get a good source of turmeric and mix that in, take that every day with some turmeric and mix some beet juice, not beet extract or beet crystals in there. Man, you'll be feeling good. You'll be feeling real good. And of course, anti-inflammatory diet. The things that kind of we all kind of know nutritionally. You know, you hope that the patients are on that, but you know, a little cheating off that once in a while is always good. So, you know, broccoli, all these kind of nutritional things. Things with colors are very good. I think the barbecue periodontal treatment is very critical. Good barbecue cures everything. Right, Joe? You know it. That's right. Okay, and xylitol is a big deal, right? Xylitol has been shown. I mean, basically what it does is starves the bugs. But also there have been some signs. It's interesting, some research came out. The xylitol is acting as an anti-inflammatory agent. I'm not sure how that really is working out. But it shifts the pH once again. And remember, those bugs are a reflection of the environment. As you have a kind of a higher pH, you know, the pH of the oral cavity, which is what, 6.8, theoretically 7. That's a different microenvironment than when you're starting dropping down to fives or so, very acidic. So you want to maintain the pH properly in there. Because remember also, when you're digesting food, what's so important about maintaining a good oral pH is that the enzyme activities there are pH dependent. What do we digest in the oral cavity? We start to do what? Sugars and what? Fats, okay? Sugars and fats. And enzymes are pH dependent. A very infected, okay, cavity, it's oral cavity, the pH is absolutely lower, and that will certainly contribute to lack of proper digestion. And so the xylitol comes in all different times of forms. You know, they're even coming in. A friend of mine makes chocolate with xylitol, which is not too bad. And listen, you know what? The tradition, salt and baking soda. I mean, that's been around forever. The salt, you know, affects a lot of the bacteria. Looks, you know, suck that, you know, crenate them out. Some bacteria can't handle a saline environment too high. And, of course, what does baking soda do? As long as you don't use it to soil your teeth off, it shifts once again. You're changing the ecology. You're elevating the pH by alkalinizing it, the old traditional salt and baking soda. So, once again, the bottom line is that, you know, all the cool things we do, if they don't keep their mouth clean, it just doesn't matter. So, subsequent appointments, you know, the number of based on his patient's response, you know, there's no lockstep as far as patient's number of appointments. And we try to keep them working until we find them responding correctly and maintain themselves, okay? So, once again, subsequent appointments, you know, re-irrigate them. Get in there, recuratage things, clean things up, do an assessment on the microscope. Keep reinforcing. Keep cleaning, cleaning, cleaning until you have an ecology that's conducive to health and wellness itself. And the end point, there is no end point. That's what I tell my patients, you are here forever. There is no escape. It's like the Twilight Zone. Twilight Zone of dentistry, okay? So we see, you know, the absence of those, you know, those pathogenic forms per se. We see the tissue responding. They're keeping their hygiene up, you know. Don't get hung up on pocket depth. Remember pockets, so we have to eliminate all the pockets. Well, I don't know, we used to do perio surgeries a year ago, and probably all the perio surgery we did, those teeth are probably gone by now, which has been shown statistically. So pocket depth is really not an issue. It's just a matter of with the irrigation, then be able to keep it as clean as possible. So don't get really hung up there. And, you know, maintenance, once again, frequency is based on clinical exam. And, you know, their cycles are really dependent on what their needs are. We don't get really hung up on 3, 6 months, whatever, what they need. Like I said before, some patients need every couple of months. Some patients need every 6 months. I mean, I sit down with patients and I'm talking to them like I talked to them a couple of months ago and I haven't seen them for 2 years. And I'm looking, everything looks beautiful. Everything looks beautiful. Time flies when you're having fun, okay? It's another typical New Jersey patient right here, but we're getting better at those. In surgery, you know, when I think back to all the surgeries we used to do, I go, ooh, nasty as hell, okay? So the last resort is surgery, and you can be very, you know, definitive on where you want to go with surgery. We're seeing some procedures now where it's on the regrow bone back up, you know, the PRF concepts and all those. Those are wonderful things, but, you know, that's to me still the last resort because this is nasty as hell. And they get all kinds of complaints. And we're seeing kind of therapies associated with LINAP, you know, laser-assisted reattachment procedures. That seems to be effective. We can like to combine that with ozone therapies, keep things clean. This is another little trick I picked up last year, perioscopy. So you have to have a third hand for this, where you actually have a little, you know, fiber optic instrument that goes down into the pocket so you see if you got all the calculus and tartar off. So it's kind of like an interesting perioscopy. It's an interesting instrument itself. And, of course, you know, imagine healing, you know, periodontal disease with really oxygen and water. And this is the one that we love, and we trained a lot of dentists and hygienists just using oxygen and water. Because the ozone effectively, you know, eliminates bacteria, virus, fungus, parasites without any toxicity or side effects. Any toxicity, you cannot be allergic to ozone. And the beauty of it, the commonality of all these particular pathogenic forms, let's call them, is all these bugs have very weak to no antioxidant systems in their cell membranes. So they're susceptible to oxidative therapies, okay? And that's the beauty of it, where ozone is an oxidative therapy. Oxidative therapy stresses these and actually kills them, ruptures their cell membranes or encapsids off the viruses themselves. Why we love ozone, okay, this is the part I like, is that we use all different type of modalities of using ozone for periodontal infections or disease. You know, we use irrigation with ozonated water, which I showed you before. We actually use insufflation, where we actually take the gas and bubble it down into the pockets. Ozone, oxygen ozone, which is really a combination of, when it's in a biologic system or in a pocket, instantly goes into solution. and creates hydrogen peroxides. Those peroxides would actually go into solution and actually track down the bugs and kill them. We can infuse ozone for difficult areas. We use the vascular supply to infuse oxygen ozone into the area. We use a microbaric trays, which are actually special trays that fit over the entire arches of these infected areas and flow oxygen ozone over those. Those are great for desensitizing roots, but also eliminating infection. And of course, application of ozonated oil. Ozonated olive oil is awesome for any kind of infection. Fantastic. As soon as you get a good quality ozonated oil, you can't go wrong. We have patients massage that into the pockets themselves, and that keeps it really super, super clean. The beauty of ozone therapy is all we're doing is what the body does naturally to eliminate pathogenic forms. This is how the immune system works, okay? We found this out back in 2002 at Scripps Institute. They were doing studies, and they came across the concept that they were understanding that antibodies, which were designed, we thought, as identifiers. We'd seen an invasion of bacteria. What happens? Plasma cells start producing antibodies. Those antibodies go tag onto these bacterial forms and start sending out cytokines to identify, send information out. What they came to realize was that the antibodies were actually producing ozone. So antibodies are actually attacking the bugs and also identifying them. And further studies went on to show that neutrophils and all these macrophages are actually using a water catalytic pathway, taking water, converting it to ozone, and that's how they're killing the pathogenic forms. We thought that was a little bit different in the past. We thought it was, as I said earlier today, about enzyme systems breaking it up, but actually producing ozone. And they found that out because neutrophils, they found, were packed with vitamin C. Why would a neutrophil pack itself with vitamin C? Well, it's called self-preservation. As the cells start to produce ozone, which is a high, strong oxidant to kill the pathogenic form they engulfed, okay, they start releasing vitamin C to protect themselves from their own oxidative stresses. Amazing biology, to say the least. And you can see the effects on a petri dish of different agents from iodine all the way up to hydrogen peroxide, how effectual they are on breaking the membranes. How you kill the bugs? You got to break up their membranes themselves. And this is beauty where we love putting the ozone. Insufflation means blowing into the gas into the pockets. It does a couple of cool things. Number one, actually desensitizes the roots, so you're not going to have postoperative sensitivity. But when the conversion comes from the gases into the peroxides, that will travel into the tissue for those invasive species we talked about. So we don't have to get reoccurrence of infection. So those invasive species are also attacked from the peroxides produced from the ozone itself. And this is a typical ozone generator. This is our highly technical handpiece that actually with a site delivery cannula that goes down into the patient itself. And so we produce ozone directly in here. And you can see we place it up in the periodontal pocket and with the little saliva ejector to pull off the extra gas itself. And the beauty thing is about this is when after you do a curettage, you have some blood, blow some ozone up in there. Instead of that dark black, kind of gray, dark brownish type of blood coming out, all this beautiful type of oxygenated blood comes out of the pocket itself. And then here we, use a procedure where we actually use the blood supply, think in the vascular sense, of placing ozone down into the buccal mucosa. And what it has is, like I said before, the ozone goes instantly into solution. It's vastly different from air. What it does is it's picked up by the small capillary beds and delivered deeply into the tissue itself. Because when you think about it, in traditional model of periodontal care, we've always been treating inside the pocket. Our world is inside the pocket, right? And everything's the pocket, pocket, pocket. Well, to really treat it, we also attack it this way. We put the ozone down at the base of the buccal mucosa, put a little bit of gas down there, it goes in the solution. Those peroxides are picked up by these deeper vascular beds. So now we're approaching periodontal care by the structures, deeper structures in here, and also both ways. So we get into those deeper capillary beds, which are capillary loops from the oral epithelium. So what we're trying to do is restore the capillary flow, restore the matrix, and therefore, once those things are restored, the epithelial cells will follow suit, and you get the healing effect that we really need. And we can also selectively infuse into the difficult papilla that we find. So the microbiome is really a reflection of you. And, what you are is really The microbiome is a reflection of you, what you eat, your habits, what you do every day, your living environment, your hygiene, and your whole body itself. So we can have another whole discussion on the microbiome or the oral cavity, but I want to just introduce a little bit the concept of rebiosis. So as we go in there, clean out all the bugs, right? We want to disrupt, kill everything, kill it all. But don't forget we have a symbiotic relationship with those bugs themselves, okay? The microbiologic positive commensal bacteria itself. So what we do refluorination, or what's called rebiosis. This is where it's going to become more and more important that elevate the consciousness of the patients where they are now developing oral probiotics. Those oral probiotics, I think, are critical. What we typically do is after we do all our hygiene cleanup to patients, we reinfuse good bacteria down into those pockets itself. If I had another couple of hours, I can really get into the concept. So basically, we're taking some sodium chloride itself, low saline solution, crushing up probiotics, and then actually flooding those pockets and rebiotic of the pockets itself. We're reintroducing a microflora into the oral cavity itself. Once again, we're thinking about keeping a microflora healthy, a good, positive environment. So other than cleaning up, we're also putting probiotics and good bacteria back in. Because the bacteria get in, they line the pockets themselves. Bacteria work by actually attaching to the epithelium itself. There's an attachment process, and we refluorinate our oral cavity, and then have them take their oral flora home with them. And in addition to regular probiotics themselves, we're really into the probiotic concept, and it's really made a huge, huge difference in their overall health and wellness on multiple levels itself. So the reality, it's all about ecology, cleaning things up, keeping the ecology. We took kind of like a went into the rabbit hole today looking at the different type of bugs, but it all boils down to thinking differently, thinking biologically, thinking about the ecology, okay? We love to clean things up, but also, once again, don't forget you are dental healers itself. So enjoy Reno, and I want to thank Oratech and Bill Landis for all the help. And I hope I didn't put you right to sleep too long. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.